and synagogues and mosques wherein the name of Allah is oft commemorated. And Allah will surely help one who helps him. Allah is indeed powerful, mighty. The Holy Quran specifically makes it clear that this type of jihad is that of fighting only against those who first attack Muslims. And other verses of the Quran lend support to these conditions. Muslims can only raise their swords against those who first raise hostilities against them, and then only if they are oppressed or have been wronged. This is the spirit and essence of Islamic jihad that has been so maliciously misportrayed. It is totally wrong to assume that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam offered people the choice of conversion or death, Islam or the sword. The jihad with the sword, which the Holy Prophet and early Muslims had to wage under their own peculiar circumstances, was a passing phase in the establishment and the foundations of Islam. Those who sought to destroy Islam by the sword perished by the sword. Unless a people or nation wage war against Muslims in order to exterminate Islam, no fight or war in which Muslims are engaged can be called jihad. The object of the Muslims taking up arms was never to deprive anybody of their homes or possessions or their freedom. It was solely to fight in self-defense, to save Islam from extermination, and to establish freedom of conscience and thought, as well as helping to defend other places of worship belonging to different religions from being desecrated or destroyed. In short, the primary objectives of the wars of Islam was to establish freedom of belief and worship, and to fight in defence of honour and freedom against unprovoked attacks. And this will always be the case, if the time ever arises again. Early Muslims had no choice but to go to war, because they were constrained to do so. Aggressive wars were and are still forbidden by Islam. The political power of Muslims must never, ever be used for self or grandiose ambitions, but for the improvement of the poor and the promotion of peace and progress. There can be no greater example of this than when the Holy Prophet ﷺ and his followers victoriously returned to Mecca. He addressed the Meccans and said, "You have seen how true the promises of God have proved. Now tell me what punishment you should have for the cruelties and enormities you committed against those whose only fault was that they invited you to the worship of one and only God." To this the Meccans replied, "We expect you to treat us as Joseph treated his erring brothers." Hearing their plea, the Holy Prophet ﷺ immediately declared, "By God, you will have no punishment today and no reproof." The Holy Quran states, "And fight them until there is no persecution, and religion is holy for Allah. But if they desist, then surely Allah is watchful of what they do." This verse shows that fighting was to be continued only so long as there was persecution, and until men were free to profess the religion they liked. If the opponents of Islam stopped fighting, then the Muslims were to stop. If any people were ever deserving of any punishment, it had to be the people of Mecca. If Islam was spread by the sword, then this occasion of the Holy Prophet ﷺ's victorious return to Mecca would have been the perfect time to wield the sword for punishment and conversion. But no, the people of Mecca were not converted by force. They were converted by love. Love of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, and love of the emancipating, enlightening and civilizing teachings of the Holy Quran. The Holy Quran states there should be no compulsion in religion. Surely right has become distinct from wrong. This verse warns Muslims in the clearest and strongest of words not to resort to force for converting non-Muslims to Islam. It also gives the reason why it should not be used, intimating that the true path has become distinct from the wrong one, and therefore there is no justification for using force. The Holy Prophet ﷺ is clearly warned by God not to use force in an attempt to reform society. His status is made clear in the following verses of the Holy Quran. which state, "Admonish therefore, for thou art but an admonisher. You are not a warden over them." Amazingly, this last verse was revealed at Mecca in the early years of the Prophet's call, and he was warned in advance that he would gain great power, but should not use it for imposing his will on others. Essentially, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not convert by the sword, but by his righteousness, his purity, love, and devotion to God, which completely overwhelmed his enemies, so much so that those whose intentions were to murder him were later to lay at his feet and give their lives to save him from his oppressors. During his last pilgrimage, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the closing words of his farewell address, said, "Even as this month is sacred, this land inviolate, and this day holy, so has God made the lives, property, and honour of every man sacred. To take any man's life or his property, or attack his honour, is as unjust and wrong as to violate the sacredness of this day, this month, and this territory. What I command you today is not meant only for today, it is meant for all time. You are expected to remember it and act upon it until you leave this world and go to the next to meet your Maker." In conclusion, he said, "What I have said to you, you should communicate to the ends of the earth. Maybe those who have not heard of me may benefit more than those who have heard." The Holy Prophet's great concern for the welfare of the whole of mankind and for establishing peace throughout the world knew no bounds. It is such a tragedy that for the last 1,000 years or so, many Muslim leaders and Muslim nations have, to a large extent, ignored the true teachings of the Holy Quran and the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to satisfy their greed and lust for power and material means. They have fought against each other for these worldly gains, and through their injustice have persecuted the innocent and acclaimed the guilty. They have treacherously betrayed their own countrymen and their fellow Muslim nations, and accepted monetary gain, power, and property from the enemies of Islam. Most of the spiritual and temporal leaders have misled their own people and brought wholesale corruption of body, mind, and soul. In this day and age, young Muslim men and women have been brainwashed into believing their acts of barbarism, terrorism, suicide, and murder will gain them martyrdom. In short, they have brought dishonor to the door of the religion they profess to love. The name of Islam is now equated with terror instead of peace. Most countries of the world have fought political battles, but it seems Muslim countries have only ever fought jihad, and in doing so, they have slaughtered one another. This is such a tragedy. In this regard, it is impossible for me not to mention the events which occurred in New York last September, or for that matter, the ongoing events in Afghanistan and the Middle East, where so-called Islamic jihad is being waged indiscriminately by Muslim organizations against non-Muslim nations. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned that the Muslims in the latter days, and especially their leaders, would be far removed from the true Islam, and that some would be the worst of creation. These leaders are misleading young, intelligent Muslim men and women. They have trained and indoctrinated them into believing that if they give their lives in what they erroneously believe is in the cause of Islam, they will immediately gain paradise as martyrs to the faith. What lies and what deceit! All Muslims should ask them, on whose authority do they make this claim? Oh, you young Muslims who are being asked to commit such terrible acts, if, as they say, you will become a martyr and enter paradise, then surely they should lead the way if what they ask you to do is such a meritorious act. Again, ask of them, why do you say what you do not do? Far from being a meritorious act, it is an act that is an outrage to the name of Islam and a defiance of the commands of God. The Holy Quran clearly states, "O ye who believe, devour not your property among yourselves by unlawful means, except that you earn by trade with mutual consent. And kill not yourselves Surely Allah is merciful to you. The words, kill not yourselves, prohibit and outlaw acts of suicide. On the other hand, is the murder of innocent people such a meritorious act that will gain a Muslim entry into paradise? Far from it. It is an open door to the fire of hell. Abu Zaid ibn Thabit ibn Dahak relates that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he who takes a false oath, that if he is not telling the truth, he might become a follower of a faith other than Islam, is already, as he describes himself. He who kills himself with an instrument will be tormented with that instrument on the day of judgment. A person cannot offer as a vow that which does not belong to him. Cursing a believer is equal to slaying.